We're just going to do whatever we're going to do today. If people start showing up, fantastic. Next month, I understand that we should be able to be back at the EOC. That's number one. Number two, I expect, I hope that neighborhood councils, since their elections are now done, would be getting their rosters in, so that when I send out an e-blast to neighborhood councils, oh good, Bob is here, we can start. And he knows where the place is, but when I send out, I can tell that rosters haven't been updated, because when I send out a universal e-blast, it's by the number of bounce backs that I get. You know, I used to get a certain number, then it began to double, and pretty soon it began to triple.
I've been a member of our board for 6 years, and for the past 3 months, my name has suddenly disappeared from the roster.
Our whole roster, half of our roster disappeared.
I can believe it. I can fully believe it. You know, I sent ours in, and I went back and checked. And on the website now, every one of our members are there. I don't know if the emails are working. I haven't tried.
I get your email.
Okay, but I do know they're there. So, once this is all done, for our next meeting, I'm going to send out a general citywide e-blast and say, hey, if you haven't got somebody coming, send somebody. Let's get this doing again. And we've got some real exciting little exercises planned. You might remember there was a gentleman there from Disaster Control, from DCS, Robert W1AW. He's W1AW is national. But he's got a real clever exercise that will help people understand what it really is like out in the field using a radio, but we won't have to use radio. And I thought it was really very clever, and we'll do that. We'll have fun.
Whisper in each other's ear?
Almost. But you'll learn what it's like. And anybody here have shortwave listening ability? Okay, if you do, listen across the amateur bands today, starting at 1800 UTC, which would be 1 o'clock here, 1 p.m. And today is what we call field day. And there's a number of thousand amateur radio operators. That's why some of the other people aren't here today. And they're a temporary radio station. And they're proving that they can go any place, throw antennas up in trees, get their batteries. Matter of fact, I talked to one of our guys today, and he is up on Blue Ridge, up in Angeles Crest. He took his hammock up there a couple of days ago, camped out, and he'll be operating today until after sundown. And then he says he'll break things down. But he's up there proving that he can be up on the top of a mountain with a wire up in a tree and a battery and his radio and operate on an emergency thing. So if you do have shortwave listening, go on the amateur band and listen around.
What frequency is it going to be on?
It's going to be on every place. If you have regular shortwave listening, it's usually on what we call low band, so it would be somewhere around 14 190 up to about 14 350, and then you'd be listening somewhere around 15 meters. Bob, where does 15 meters start? If I'm sitting for my radio, but if you listen around 21 235 down to about 21 150, you'll hear people in there. Later this evening, on about 7.175 up to about 7.285, somewhere in there, you'll be hearing people. Yeah, I know. Along with the foreign broadcast.
How many are willing to admit that you're old enough to be trained on a straight key?
Some people here are willing to admit that they don't know what the world he said for the last 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. What this is.
That's why we have.
Yeah. What it is amateur radio operators, the people that you've seen here and what we've talked about, the guys from ACS and DCS, and ARIES, and I'll have that as part of my agenda. We operate on certain shortwave frequencies that the FCC says we're were allowed to use. And what we call the low bands, in other words, the ones that go long distances, run anywhere from 10 meters, that's the wavelength, all the way up to 160 meters, which means a really big antenna. And there are radios that you can buy, either things in a case that you can tune around and listen to worldwide shortwave. There still are a number of stations on that broadcast. They broadcast news, music, talk shows, you name it, around the world. And then the amateurs, and the amateurs are in this one area. And when I say 7 point whatever, that's 40 meters.
Yeah.
And if I say 21 point something, that's 15 meters.
Yeah, Glenn, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to be more detailed, because either you're into the ham radios or you're not.
But the ones that are important to the people here are these things that these little handheld people have. And those we call VHF, very high frequency, and UHF, ultra high frequency. And they depend on two things. One, they're fairly line of sight, or they depend upon repeaters up on hilltops. And this is the kind of thing I'm talking about. And with this, because of its technology through the internet, I can talk to all of Southern California, I can talk to all of California, I can talk over to the United Kingdom if I want to, what's left of it. but generally, these will be used by emergency people, by ACS, by DCS, to communicate to the various bureaus, fire, police, emergency management, who will then talk to the EOC where we've usually been. Okay? These will be the things that are used.
Should that be a budget item for the neighborhood council?
Probably not. Probably not. Well, it could be if you have people who are either ham radio operators or willing to be. The problem is, if you want to get real technical, the neighborhood council is supposed to keep possession of their inventory. Okay? And if you have a bunch of these stashed at your neighborhood council office, and you have an earthquake, how do you get people to have one?
You don't.
Okay, by the way, you can buy a radio today, a Baofeng radio that handles VHF and UHF, for $35. I'm not saying they're the best in the world, but they're very handy and they're very utility, and if they break, you can throw them away and get another one. They're a throwaway. But you have to have an amateur radio license. Mary Garcia from
Navajo.
I was going to say they want to change their name.
Navajo.
What are they now?
Midtown.
North Carolina.
Right, Navajo. Yeah.
They picked up a large number of what we call, remember we had a talk about FRS, Family Radio Service? They picked up a number of those. And one of the gentlemen, Zimmerman, who's been to our meetings and told us of a plan, they actually used the FRS radios in connection with CERT in the search of a two-story building recently. And they found that they worked very, very well in conjunction with the ham operator. And for the FRS radios, for the family radio service radios, you don't need a license.
Basically, to hitchhike on the question you'd asked, sir, our neighborhood council bought 10 of these, and rather than giving it to individuals, because you are responsible as a neighborhood council for them. Michael Shankla, who works with Zimmerman, okay?
Yeah, I know him.
I know very well. I mean, obviously, you guys have spoken. Has organized something, and basically, we've given the responsibility for our radios to the ACS group, who are basically loaning them to individuals in our area. And he has about 10 people, and he's looking for more people to expand on it.
Yeah, yeah. And by the way, anybody who wants their ham radio, basic radio license, so they can work a radio like the one I just showed you. There are a number of places around. One that I like the best is Norm Goodkin. And Norm, every quarter, has a class. You do a little studying, to begin with, and then one Sunday morning, you schlep all the way out to Lost Hills Sheriff Station out of the valley. You do a one-day course, they feed you lunch. I think they charge now $55 for the exam, for your licensing, for all the other stuff, and lunch. And it's about a 95% pass rate. I go out there and I help with the exams. So about 95% of the people walk out of there with their basic amateur license. Some never go beyond that, others do. But that's what you need for emergency communication.
It's a two-man team.
Huh?
Norm and Naomi.
Yes. You cannot leave out Naomi. She's the driving force.
And that's a tech license.
That's the tech license.
And you can just renew it for the rest of your life.
Yeah. You can renew your tech license for as long as you want to. Every 10 years, you get a new license. It doesn't cost you anything. As I say, some people have gone up. Some people find it fun with these new things. Anybody here do programming? Computer programming?
A little bit.
Anybody know what a Raspberry Pi is, a miniature computer?
Yeah.
Well, they're using Raspberry Pis and custom-made boards to let you connect into the internet through your telephone, and you talk in a radio, and you can talk all over the world from a little handheld using your little personal hotspot. So if you're having fun with the internet, this is the kind of thing you can do. Getting out of this, we have a visitor, Marissa, from the mayor's office.
Public safety.
They're trying to put together a program, and she wanted to have a couple of minutes to talk. I'm sorry that more people didn't show up today. We got our base. And I'm going to let her address us for a couple of minutes, tell us what they're looking for there. And I've already told her that we're probably going to use her services, her good office, for some of the things we may be looking for, and it, good synergistic relationship. That's basically what we need. As you notice, one of the things on the agenda today talked about how to integrate us into the city family, basically. How can we work with the different city departments? Well, here's one of the ways we may be able to, because if the mayor's office supports it, we've got it. Marissa, come on up and talk to us.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How are you? Kind of informal, and it's Saturday morning, right? It would be helpful for me to just quickly know which neighborhoods are represented. Do we mind doing that really quickly?
No, I'll tell you what, let's start with Bob.
San Pedro.
Okay.
West Hills.
Valley Village.
Bel Air, Beverly Crest, Neighborhood Council.
North Air, Neighborhood Council, Brandon, USC. Three Neighborhood Councils, Studio City, Sherwood Oaks, and Tewick Lake.
I'm Jeff Cochran, the best.
North Hills West.
Lake Balboa, Neighborhood Council.
North Ridge West.
Montage.
Montage, San Jacinto.
Tarzana. What kind of valley guy?
Well, I am a valley girl, so that works out. I live in Studio City, so I will stand because I can't see all of you. So I just wanted to take a few moments of your time this morning. Thank you so much. This was sort of a quickly arranged thing last night, which means it's meant to be, to let you know sort of my role, what we're trying to accomplish in the mayor's office and the Office of Resilience. And so I'm the Chief Resilience Officer for Mayor Garcetti, and I understand that my deputy mayor, Jeff Correll, has been to one of your meetings, so I work directly for him. The city in December of 2013 was announced as one of the initial members of the Rockefeller Foundation-funded 100 Resilient Cities program. Mm. Has anybody heard of 100 Resilient Cities? Yeah, a little bit? Okay, so basically what the 100 Resilient Cities program does is they support a position like mine. It's the first of its kind in Los Angeles and in these other cities. And so they recently announced their last batch of cities, so now they actually have 100 cities that they're planning to support chief resilience officers in each of those cities, and then they do three other things. They give us access to some support in the form of consultants to come up with a citywide resilience strategy, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a minute. And then they also provide us with additional tools for sort of assessing our resilience and both determining what might be in that strategy and then most importantly implementing strategies, right? And then the fourth thing is that we are establishing this pretty impressive network of chief resilience officers in each of these cities. And as you know, cities have similar resilience challenges and then different ones. And so I work regularly with the chief resilience officers in San Francisco, Oakland, and Berkeley, in Mexico City, in Christchurch, and in New Orleans, and around the world. In trying to innovate around how we can build additional resilience and how each city doesn't work in a silo, but we can learn from each other and share best practices. And so one of the most favorite things that I get to do is share some of the first things and best things and greatest things that we're doing in Los Angeles with some of these other cities. So that's a little bit about how I got here, and I've been with the city for just over a year. And part of my sort of role and portfolio is to implement all of the strategy or the recommendations in the Mayor's Resilience by Design Report. So Dr. Lucy Jones, seismologist formerly at USGS, she just retired, but she's still around if you watch the news. So she was with the Mayor's office for a year developing 17 recommendations, including building retrofits, strengthening our water system and our telecommunication system. So she regularly will joke that she got to come up with those 17 ideas with all of the partners that she worked with, but I have to get to implement them. So we're working on that. And then also, I assume that you all are familiar with the city sustainability plan.
Yeah.
The plan, capital L, capital A.
So, the 2 sentence reminder.
Oh, sure. So in April of 2015, the mayor's office delivered a sustainable city plan. It has about 250 short-term, mid-term, and long-term goals in 14 areas that are really focused on the environment, the economy, and equity. And one of those 14 chapters of recommendations is on preparedness and resilience. And if you're not familiar with that in this group, I encourage you.
We've heard a lot of lectures, so thank you.
Fantastic. So that is really focused on urban heat island effect and a number of other currently identified issues. And so I'm working with our sustainability team and others in the city to implement those. Third. So in addition to all of that, like I said, we're developing a citywide resilience strategy, and so we've been assessing through all of the resilience building efforts that are currently going on in the city, and there are a lot, and then looking at what else is going on in the city and encouraging those efforts to look at whatever they're doing with a bit more of a resilience lens. And the lens that we're trying to encourage is not only sort of a disaster preparedness lens, but also the idea that if we strengthen the community fabric on, many of you know Jim Featherstone, I'm going to use one of his words, but on a blue sky day, then we'll be better prepared to react to an interruption or a major disaster. And so looking both at sort of the community building aspect and the emergency preparedness aspect and the sustainability aspect and bringing those all together and breaking down silos, which is pretty much what I do every day. And then there are other things that would help our resilience that maybe we're not addressing, and there are a few gaps and holes and we're trying to identify those. And so based on that effort, we've come up with 5 focus areas. So those focus areas are, I'm going to do my best to remember the exact words, are building disaster resilience for today and tomorrow, are addressing equitable climate adaptation, are looking at our aging infrastructure and improving that, and then increasing access and opportunity for all Angelinos, really looking at equity. And then finally, fostering better communication through partnerships. And those are our five sort of not-so-focused areas. And so over the summer, we're going to be holding a number of resilience academies on a few different issues. And one of our plans is to hopefully figure out how best to work with all of you and your neighborhood councils to run a few resilience academies, to teach people a little bit more about resilience, and then most importantly, to you know, have this dialogue with you all about what the neighborhood councils can be doing in neighborhoods to increase resilience and how we can support you in doing that. So, I think I got it all. Any questions? Yes?
That's kind of a question, but you don't have to. But just one of the things that would help neighborhood councils, because we, you know, we have a full breadth of everything the city does, plus we have our own, you know, small, tiny little budget that we, you know, take some of our time, and we're all volunteers. So I guess my comment is that all these things, to the extent that they can be made almost like deliver, you know, just ready to go, easy. Just like you've done all the work type of thing. I mean, hopefully we can be involved, that'd be great. But the end product is you give something to neighborhood councils, it's like, okay, if you want to do this, here's a checklist, or here's your promotional materials, here's your template news release. All that stuff really helps us as volunteers to get stuff done. Because when we have to spend the time to then find someone to do it, figure it out, spend the time, whatever, you know, it slows it down, or maybe just gets put aside with all the competition and everything else. So to the extent you're able to have that as be a template type of a thing you just hand, would be helpful.
I appreciate that. I too am a volunteer, and I get that. Yes.
Couple of things to think about. One is how you would propose neighborhood councils can aid in these summer resilience academies. What can we do to help promote them? Because if you don't advertise them well, as I say, nobody's going to come anyway. Number two is to facilitate, and I know it gets difficult, neighborhood councils. Now, a lot of people can make it on Saturdays, mm-hmm. but a lot can't. Mm-hmm. So you might consider the use of something like the Deaton for an evening type of affair, mm-hmm. something on that order, because now you get different groups.
Right.
So those are just two things that I could put out there. And yes, I would agree with Glenn. If it's a checklist, it works better. Because you always get the complaint, "Hi, I'm a volunteer. I don't have time."
Oh. Okay.
Also, you will also get a number of people saying, "Well, we only meet once a month, and now we're going to have to work on something to come up with a plan." If that plan is in place for them for that once a month, it's going to be a lot easier. And where can we find, if I put it out, one? If you'll get to me the Resilience by Design report,
yeah.
where it can be, and
I'll send you all the materials.
Good, as long as they're online,
yeah.
so that we can get them out to the neighborhood council and say, here it is, here's where you can find it. You know, save the environment, don't print it if you don't have to.
So I've been trying my best to organize all of the things that my office is doing on one single page on the mayor's website. So it should have most of those links, and also we held a retrofit resource fair for a number of the building owners that have been asked to retrofit their buildings. So that information is there.
Just one other thing, and on what you were mentioning, maybe some webinars would get to a lot of people. if you can get people interested in this to start with, and it's the best way to recover. And all the major companies use that as far as training, information.
We actually had a great sort of brainstorming session yesterday that was all about needing five different ways to communicate with people in order to hit, you know, a good percentage of the population.
I think I heard you say you would like to have at least a few neighborhood councils involved in what is academy presentation things.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be happy to talk to you about that.
Fantastic. I'm gonna work with Tracy and others to figure out exactly how to make it fit within the existing schedules and so that it's not extra work, recognizing that you're all volunteers.
Okay. Recognize the fact that right now, first, second, third, and fourth Saturdays of every month has some type of alliance meeting. So that's one of your problems.
It's an opportunity.
Yeah.
And that's how I feel about that.
It is fifth Saturdays.
Yeah. The other is...
Or afternoons.
The other is, this is just one. You've been here.
Yeah.
You might want to...
I'm going to make it around.
You know all the alliances?
I'm learning.
If not, we can help you with it. Tell you who the contact points are. Specifically, and as I say, I think next month we'll have a larger crowd because people will be back where they're familiar.
It's summer. I feel like everybody's on vacation.
Well, not quite, but you know, we'll be able to contact more people, and I think they like going to the EOC better. It's a lot more exciting.
It's a good building.
Yeah. And you feel more at home there because that's where we started.
I actually drove there.
Huh?
My car took me right there.
Right there. Whoops, wrong place. Yeah. But.
Thank you. I have cards too. Oh, right.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
And anything.
Thank you.
Anything specific that you would like from the different organizations, I would suggest rather than just general resilience, you know, you've got your five different areas. That you take a look at the different groups, like this group is interested in emergency preparedness, and focus on that portion of your five.
Sure. So I particularly saw on your agenda this official communications effort. So that's sort of our fifth one, is how to foster better dialogue.
Okay.
So I saw a direct relationship there.
Okay.
But yeah, I also, if anyone has a really good idea or something that you wanted to see happen for 10, 20 years, let me know.
Okay.
Let me know what that is.
Go ahead.
Just piggybacking on Len's comment on alliances. So we have citywide alliances, but we also have regional alliances.
Yes.
And if you're planning to do these academies on a regional basis, it'd be particularly important to coordinate with those regional alliances where they exist in the city. So we have them for the Valley, the Harbor, the west side, the one that's sort of the east side, and we have South LA.
Sure.
The majority of neighborhood councils are covered there. And then the other thing that I'd like to stress, and the department has heard of, but it doesn't always happen, is if you're targeting, let's say the Valley.
The Department.
Of Neighborhood Empowerment. I keep saying, if you're planning something that you want all neighborhood councils to participate in, then schedule it for a night when no neighborhood councils are meeting
in
that region.
Which is almost impossible.
It is.
Sunday
at it's not evening. Impossible. So like in the Valley.
Friday night.
No.
The fourth, in the Valley, for example, the fourth Monday, currently, no neighborhood council has regular board meetings.
Really?
And also, if there happens.
All the third.
The fourth Monday. And then also if there's a fifth Monday or Tuesday, fifth week of the month.
If there's a fifth Saturday.
If anything.
Yeah, if anything, you're right.
Except not in July because we have budget day in July this time. But, and that's a citywide event. But the point is when you're looking at a region, if the purpose is to get, trying to get all the neighborhood councils participating, for that region, just look and see where they meet. Citywide, there is something happening every night, no question. But within each region, it is possible to find a night or two. The Valley's got 34 neighborhood councils, so there's a lot more there.
Yeah.
But the other regions are smaller.
Yeah.
Oh boy. What I hear is a lot of trying to force a square peg into the round hole of neighborhood council, administration, bureaucracy, and stuff. So I want to give you some feedback, which is, okay, I live in San Pedro, been there for about 16 and a half years.
Fantastic.
And some number of years ago, before I lived there, a freighter blew up at the dock. The deck house went up into the air, we don't know how many hundred feet, came down in the shack. The person who was supposed to be in the shack has never been found, was probably rammed into nothing. That's called the Sansania, it's kind of famous in the area. Those of us with a little bit of a chemistry background wonder about, well, what happens about a ship that comes into port and starts leaking something toxic. What do you do? How do you get people out of the area? Well, I've been asking that question for about 14 of those 16 and a half years. And when you talk to the police officers and the firemen, you get a kind of a mumble response. Well, we have a plan. Well, what's the plan? Well, you know, I don't have it with me. Do you have a plan for getting people out of the area? Well, we do have a plan. You know, well, what is it? Are we all going to go north? Are we all going to go south? Because there's really only two streets that will get you out of San Pedro, et cetera. And this is important, Len, so don't wave at me. Okay, the point is that there is no communication with the public whatsoever. If there is a plan, we've not been told about it. We ask about it. This is nonsense. Nothing has been done. It's at all useful. And we do have one of the biggest ham radio organizations working out of the Battleship Iowa and so on. Again, nothing. So the goal that I want to talk about in one sentence is saving lives and health after that big earthquake, what we now refer to as the Lucy Jones event. Okay? And I'm not kidding. We've heard her lecture, and we know that, you know, an hour after that earthquake, you're still on your own. A week after, you're still on your own. We know that.
And yet there are 34, 35 other faults around the city that may be more disastrous than I'm doing good.
The geophysics is not something we want to get into a long discussion on, you know. But, you know, one of the first things we ought to do is to have, how shall I call it, a 30-minute class that we can create. We can create a very short textbook for it, a video or whatever, so that we make it available to not just local neighborhood councils, but town hall forums, you know, for the whole harbor area. Mm-hmm. And we're just like 1/30th approximately of the population of LA. That was my intent on becoming involved in this organization. I think that it's, you know, as Len told us when he first started it, your people said, great idea, what took you so long? Well, we're here, ready to do it. We'll write the textbook for you. We'll work with your people to create the stuff. But we need to get beyond, well, the neighborhood councils, they're always busy. They always have a meeting, you know, on, you know, gardening or something like this. We'll just have the meetings.
Well,
you know where to find me.
Well, we will find Marissa and we'll have her back. I've got some ideas, I've got some plans. I'm not going to talk about them here right now. And we'll see what happens, but we'll need support of a lot of people around the city to get something done. Okay? It has to do with one of Greg Balboa's favorite subjects. It has to do with these large little boxes. So I'll be counting on your neighborhood council.
Thank you all so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Come prepared.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Okay. Oh.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Marissa. Okay, we're going to run through a couple of things rapidly, and then we're going to get into some serious stuff. The review, we all know we've talked about the five-step program, and I'm sure that that fits in with what Marissa's been talking about. The question, you know, because as we were told, they want to make the city disaster, they want to make the five-step program the basis of city disaster response. That may or may not work with all neighborhood councils, okay? The organization part. So I'm looking at something that may be a little more customizable. Mona has told us, and so has Larry Meyerhoff, that they may be looking for a way to customize the five-step program. And that's some of the ideas we have to come up with. What kind of things are different from the five-step as they apply to neighborhood councils? As I was talking to somebody, you come into my neighborhood in Tarzana, and you know, part of the five-step, you're supposed to break things down into small units. Well, you go to one side of the freeway, and that's where all of our condos and apartments are with some single family. You go south of the freeway in Tarzana, and you start kind of level, and then you just blow straight up, okay? And you've got level areas on the hills where they've done this wonderful thing with bulldozers and flattened things out. So how do you organize those areas within the current, or what do you have to do to customize those? As I was saying, it's a single apartment unit with, say, 150 family units. Is that one unit, or do you want to chop it into two units? What do you want? So that's the kind of thing that we have to look at with regards to the five-step program. And by the way, over there I left something that Bill Pope had sent me. It's kind of a reduced little thing. He gave me a nice book to look through, and it's a very good compilation of all the different kinds of trainings that are around. But one, the first one is CERT, and I think that we really have to work with CERT. And one of the reasons I think we have to work with it is because, once again, this is the city's unit, and they're going to rely on these people to be out there. And yeah, so if we get, somehow we get people within neighborhood councils, some of them CERT trained, or within various areas we can encourage CERT training, people know what they're doing. Mary Garcia says that the county has got a three-day course that's even superior. How many days, how many people have 3 days, okay? How many people have basically, you know, eight Tuesdays or seven Tuesdays, I can't remember.
Seven
to do it, you know, I'm going through it. But out in Tarzana and through the valley, a couple people organized a weekend boot camp, okay? And we'd have to talk to Captain Wynn, and we'd have to talk to Ignacic, John, and say, okay, can we do this again, guys? And basically what it was a two-day crash course in CERT. And you've got to be willing to come in the morning and spend 8 hours on this stuff. I mean, they had one where they actually went through, what is your favorite MRE? Okay, anybody familiar with MREs from the military? Meals ready to eat? And they actually had different ones that people could, and one of the things they said, choose something you could eat cold and like cold because you may not have boiling water to fix these. So could we look at something like that? Could we organize something like that? Would the CERT trainers be willing to do that? Maybe as suggested by some other people, there are areas of CERT training that can be handled by civilians rather than fires. Bye-bye, Marissa. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Rather than by sworn individuals, could we have civilians teaching part of the CERT stuff under supervision? There are some areas where they're going to want fire people to do it, okay? That's another way that neighborhood councils could help. So that's an idea we have to think about and see if we can do it. On to emergency community.
Sorry, on CERT.
On CERT.
So one way that I think this group could help in the power influence that you have, I have a concern that the connection, that there's not the connection between the CERT program and the neighborhood councils that there could be and ought to be. So for example, there was a cert training class that was offered a mile and a half from my neighborhood council that nobody knew about. Now, we did find out about it in advance by a few days, and so he did e-blast it out. But my point is that the neighborhood council in which it was located and directly adjacent, et cetera, was never notified about it. I know it's on the website, but it seems like we could do a better job of making this known, not just to the neighborhood council board members, but to all of our stakeholders to invite, as long as there's openings in the class, which there typically are.
So what you want is a push notification. In other words, you want cert, so on. Okay. So
I want to put the idea in their mind. I realize it's on the website.
No,
that
no.
means you go and you visit.
No, no, no.
But I'm saying, I want them to think that neighborhood councils are a partner.
That's a push system.
Okay.
It's like you don't have to go up on the website to get your email. You just turn it on at your phone and there it is. Okay, good idea. I'll talk to Captain Wynn. I'll talk to John and say, here's how you do it. Thank you.
I have a question regarding cert. My past impression has been that the fire department has control over all cert members, and if there's a disaster, they call the cert teams out, and no one else can call the cert team out. Mm-hmm. However, I saw a message somewhere within the last week or two indicating that cert members should be incorporated in local neighborhood council areas for support in their own area around their own house. Is there this control anymore over the cert members by the fire department, or can cert members use their title as a cert trained person when we have a major disaster and help people in their own neighborhood without having to worry about being called as a group to go somewhere else?
I don't know. I'm writing that down.
In the past, we have avoided using the word cert trained for fear that we're infringing on something. And so we have to find a way to work around it, because we are going to use cert folks in our own local neighborhood council emergency preparedness plan.
That's what you're supposed to do.
Okay. They do encourage.
You know, I tell you what, I got a million different things from CERT online saying, you know, we need CERT volunteers for this testing or this. Most of it's not emergencies.
Right. Yeah.
But most of it's just things you're doing. And you know, you volunteer if you desire to. You know, other than that, I'm not aware of any formal, you've got to do this, you've got to do that.
The,
go ahead.
The only thing I could think about is if you're cert trained and you're not working under something official, mm-hmm. it has to do with whether or not you're not protected by the city.
Right.
Okay. I've made a note of that. Because I know that when they talk to CERT people, one of the things they talk to them about is organizing your community, okay? So I think, you know, they're talking more independent.
Yeah, the other issue is getting a hold of a list of CERT trained people.
Now that's another subject.
I do have a workaround for it.
Okay, that's another subject, because if you'll recall, Captain Wynn, when he was with us, thought that there might be as many as 120,000 people or thereabouts that had been trained, but their database wasn't up to. Okay, so
and
maybe
they
that's
take
something.
The list, when maybe, you take a CERT class and
I know.
You sign up, you can't have that list. They won't share it.
I know, so
list.
maybe we're.
I have a workaround for that. We did a CERT training class a year and a half ago. We had 65 people in the class that completed it. The instructor had her sign-in sheet, and we had our own.
Yeah.
And we got all 65 on our own sheet.
Yeah.
Okay. They're not too hung up on doing on Saturdays, so that's doing CERT training. It takes a little bit more a push to get them to do it, like for the two Saturdays.
Well,
to have CERT.
If you have the attendance, who'll do it any time?
Yeah,
I know, but there might be a little extra cost. Yeah, yeah, well, it has. On Saturdays.
The weekend has to do with OT, yeah.
I don't know about this, if you have the attendance of the meeting, if you want to. I can't get a cert program going on in my area because they don't have enough people to do it. And they only got two instructors for the entire city.
Yeah, and that's why we've been talking about.
Only two left?
Yeah.
That's why we've been talking about possibility of civilians being able to help. Yeah, yeah.
Or Boone County, I even asked, well, can it go to the county? But they won't come, they won't cross over.
Yeah.
I just want to say there needs to be a revamp of the database for cert because there really isn't a database for cert. You know, so that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's one of the things. And right on my thing, I said, how can NCs help inventory cert training individuals? That's one of the things we have to look in. Okay.
Yeah, and there's a whole bunch of paramedics, retired and active, that don't teach classes for cert either because they can't get in yet. Now, and that's something should be addressed too.
Okay, we find ways to do it. Okay.
Liz, I'm sorry, did you say if you cert trained, you're covered for?
What? No, I'm saying if you're cert trained and you're called in officially, say, under the fire department, you may be, you know, because now you're working under the city. It's like you're a board member. If you're working within the, quote, course and scope of your employment,
Yeah. You
as a board member are indemnified by the city. Now, I don't know how it works with CERT, okay?
Yeah, I think if an emergency happened and you happen to be trained on CERT, you help somebody and something happened to him.
That's a good Samaritan law. There is a good Samaritan law.
Well, yeah, but there's been some change. There's been a well, that court decision was kind of a weird situation.
2008.
It was a very strange situation, and they've been working on correcting it. Okay, moving on.
After the meeting?
We talked about the emergency communication. We've already gone through that. All of our different groups.
What is DCS?
DCS is Disaster Communication System. They're actually under the state of California, and each of them is run by the sheriff within the county. And Bob, who was the top civilian person in DCS here in Los Angeles, came and talked to us. Robert was here that day. And then ACS, which is Emergency Communication System, is under, well, the fire, no, it's not really under the fire department. It's not truly under the fire department. Chief Nida, wonderful man that he is, for the last 17 years has had a ham radio license, and he has supervised and run the ACS program. What I found out from him is that ACS really comes under the Emergency Management Department, and he's a volunteer. He is not paid to help run ACS. He does it on a volunteer basis. They help him with his hours so that he can do it, and that's another thing I'm going to be talking to people about and with regards to ACS. And one of these days he's going to retire. Who's going to take it over? You know. And they may close station, what is it, 91 or 97 or whatever it is, south of here where ACS meets. They may sell that as surplus property. And all of a sudden they don't have a place to meet and all this kind of stuff. But these are the people that work with CERT. They are the people that the fire department depends upon and the EMD is depending upon to handle their radio communication. These are the people that neighborhood councils, as we said, are going to talk to probably. If their members find, if they're not, the ACS people will then talk to the fire station. The fire station will talk to the bureau and then down to the EOC. And that's how that works. So they are part of the city. ARES is a volunteer group once again, and that's under the American Radio Relay League. They basically work with the hospitals. And they do their training with the hospitals, and that's when you lose communication at the hospitals. They set up at the top of the parking structures. Some of the hospitals have actually got stations with antennas, and they handle all kinds of things. You can even tie into the standard email through Windmail now and everything else. But they handle all of the communications in disasters for the hospitals, okay? All right. Then there's a group called Notify LA. Everybody familiar with what Notify LA is? You can sign up for it. And it's kind of a reverse 911. It'll go to your cell phone.
Can you use Nixle?
Not Nixle. Notify LA. It goes to your, you can get it, you can sign up for it. Go online, sign up for it. You can sign up for multiple notifications. You work downtown, but you live in the valley. You want to know if something hits in the valley, you'll get it on your cell phone. If something hits downtown, you'll get it on your cell phone. So there's a way to do that. It's called Notify LA, and you just Google it, it'll come up, it's on the EMD site.
Lynn, is that the one where I'd sign up for one time, and anytime there's an accident 50 miles away, and you get a buzz, and you get about 10 of them a day, and I get rid of that after the first day?
Excuse me, I'm keeping my
question. That's Nixle?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So that's
Nixle, if you want to, go onto their website, and you can customize it. Okay. You can say, don't send me other than Valley CHP, West Valley, etc. You can customize it. Otherwise,
let me tell you the issue. The issue is this, is we've had presentations from the fire department, from emergency management, from when was at our last meeting that we just had. I haven't gotten one notification for anything in the city since I've signed up 3.5 years ago. I live about one mile away from UCLA when they had the lockdown 2 weeks ago. I didn't get any notification whatsoever.
And
there's no testing part. You sign up and you don't hear from them and you never hear from them.
Yeah.
So it doesn't work. And if there's not a sign up or a guarantee, it's an issue.
Okay, this is where
we
need to work on communication. The city's got things and they're not talking to us. I'll tell you about something else there. Yeah, but it goes to EMD. It's official thing of emergency management department.
So as opposed to police issues, you receive emergency.
You can get different notifications. Let's say we have another big one in Northridge, and you're signed up for Valley Northridge.
Well, let's have the big one in Tarzana.
My younger daughter was sleeping over at Rescue Keith Richmond's house with his daughter when the Northridge earthquake hit, and we had to remind my wife that she wasn't even home. It took me a while. Leave Tarzana out of this.
Wait a second. Was that a motion?
Yeah.
In a second.
Yeah. Now, Notify LA is somewhat different. It is more of a reverse 911 type of thing. The only problem is they've got maybe 50,000 people signed up for it right now, which isn't a whole lot of people out of 4 million, okay, in the city of Los Angeles. I think we're up to 4 million now, if not very, very close. Glenn?
Just on the Notify LA, I think probably your first meeting of this group, they had brought many of those outreach brochures.
Mm-hmm. Mona had.
So I asked and I obtained a supply. So they've been available at our neighbor council meetings. I mean, I know that's not the total solution, but the point is that they are, it's a resource for neighbor councils to get the word out that it's a pretty good brochure as far as what's offered there. So I think maybe if we could have, by we, I mean you, a supply. I'm not saying a big supply that coming down our knee, but at least to have them here.
Okay.
Just as for those people who are new and haven't seen that, it'd be a good thing for them to be aware. They could order them for their neighborhood council, for their community.
Right.
I've seen them at, I think it was emergency preparedness. Right. I mean, emergency management.
From EMD.
Yeah.
Have people been successful getting notifications from by LA? Anybody here?
Yeah.
Got a notification?
When the school.
How many times have you been on it? 3 years? Ten years?
When they closed LAUSD,
yeah.
They went out over that. Notify LA.
That's what I'm saying. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work.
Yeah. So that's something we got to talk about. I'm going to give you a little clue about something else that I want us to begin to get into, and then I'm going to jump back. I'm jumping ahead on the agenda on the backside. Where it says Emergency Operations Board, okay? Anybody ever heard of the Emergency Operations Board? They were very hard to find And then I started to talk about it, and suddenly, it's amazing, I can now find their agendas. They are a Brown-acted group, okay? Have no idea where they physically post. Absolutely none, okay? But according to the website, it's all called the Emergency Operations Board, and it's the GM of police, fire, airports, building and safety, et cetera, et cetera. And the chief of police is the chair of the of it, and the chief of the fire is the co-chair. They meet 6 times per year, third Monday, the odd months. And they say, oh, it's open to the public, 1:30 p.m. at the EOC where we meet. This is a group of top managers in the city of Los Angeles who make plans for disaster. And should a disaster hit, like when that school thing hit LAUSD, they're the ones that went into the little room, not the room we're in, but another room to the side, where they could look out into the actual EOC, yeah. And they were the ones that were there, okay?
I know that's all.
And who knew, all right? This is a group that we should somehow be monitoring. Somebody should go there, and it's open to the public. They've got the same thing, we're allowed to speak there. But if you go up on the city's website, and you go to boards and commissions, you are not going to find it.
Where do you find it?
If you go to EMD's site, you can go search for it. There's another group that I would like to see us become part of, and it's called the Emergency Preparedness Committee. I can't remember Anna's last name from EMD, but she is the one right now that handles those meetings. And they meet once a month, and these are the people that actually investigate different things for emergency planning. If you go up there and find their last agenda, there's a whole big project that they've been working on. And every other month, when the Emergency Operations Boards meet, they go to that meeting and they make a report on what they're doing, what they're working on, and that's where the recommendations come from.
Yeah, I'm with the Budget Advocates, and we audited them over the emergency management department, and we saw the downstairs
information
room. We have everybody's hooked up. They have the different colored jackets for the different things that happen. And that room in there where the mayor would come and a lot of the department heads, the chief of police, it would all be there, and then to coordinate with anybody in the field for that. So I'm aware of that. And Anna, I forgot Anna's her name, but yeah, she's the person that handles that. I can get in contact with her.
Oh, yeah, me too. Yeah. But what's amazing is I searched for the EOB, and I found a couple of old agendas. And all of a sudden, if I go to a particular portion of EMD's website, there's the committee's agendas, there's the EOB's. I don't know why they suddenly started posting them, but they sure did. Maybe it's because we're here. So those are two things that I think we should look at.
So is the EPF, the Emergency Preparedness Committee, under EMD?
Yes. Anna is, and I can get Anna's name. I've got it. Now, let's go back.
I just checked my early notifications. I get a lot of things I don't do, but so Emergency Management Committee agenda, it's sent out by early notification. You can sign up to get that. And
tell me EOB's up there now.
I have EOB, they send out minutes, but I have minutes from March that was sent in May, but no meeting.
Yeah, and if you go search the city for it, the regular website, it doesn't appear. All of a sudden, they've started posting things. I don't know why. As I say, maybe it's because we made inquiries and such and found out about them.
Okay, well, at least one of these, they are sending the agendas out. You could sign up on ENS.
I don't know if the committee is Brown-acted or not.
That's the agenda I got.
Okay, the committee is Brown-acted.
Emergency acted Preparedness
Committee.
Committee.
Okay.
June 1st.
All right. What do we know for sure? We know for sure that there's a lack of communications. We've talked about that today. We don't know. And the problem is, when we don't know, what we don't know, then we've got a problem, okay? We have to have some official status. Marissa, who is here, could probably help us with that. It's the mayor's office. If the mayor's office says to the GM, make it happen, it's going to happen, okay? So what we need is, we need better communication with the fire department, with CERT. We need better communication with EMD. We need better communication with LAPD. We need communication with all of these groups that are going to be part of it. So maybe what we really need is to be able to get official notification, et cetera, of this EOB, because they're the ones that are making the plan. Perhaps we can get some people who say, okay, I can make it down to these committee meetings, these emergency committee meetings. I can do that. And we get on the line with Anna, we say, hi, we'd like to have somebody down there at the table. We're going to listen in. We may not be part of it, but we're going to listen in. We can give you information and get that kind of communication going. That's something we have to work on. I'm throwing out things that we need to do somehow, some way. Anybody over the next month comes up with some good ideas, some thoughts, some things. Who can we talk to? Who can we contact? Can we talk to our city council members? Who do you know in the mayor's office? Things of that nature. But we need to foster communication. All right. Neighborhood council members, once we get a plan, have got to be trained in this. I hate to use the word training, but I use the word training. Educated in this. How do you organize your community? What specific ideas are you going to do for customizing? How do we take this and integrate it with some of the other stuff that the city's doing? And the stuff that Marissa's doing, CERT training, various other things within the city. How do we do this? Because every single department, as we found out, you know, when they came to talk to us, has some kind of emergency plan. How do we integrate us into that? All right? All right. Now the important part. And probably what we need to do is find some people, I was hoping there'll be more here today, but next month, that would like to be on a little bit of a committee, because what we really need is, we need a plan for neighborhood councils. As I say, the five-step is great. Some of this stuff that Bill Pope has put out is great. The CERT training is great, and the CERT idea is great. But what we really need is some kind of an outline, bullet points, whatever, like Marissa was saying, they might do what we asked her about, that neighborhood councils could customize to their area. Because we all know that one size doesn't fit all within this city. Just flat out. They've tried it, it doesn't work. It just flat out doesn't work.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
Has Matt, your neighborhood been ever brought up as part of this plan?
That could be part of it. Map your neighborhood. Now, by the way, the exercises they've gone through, one was in Tarzana, the other was down here in South LA. They work. They really, really work. But they organize just a single individual small area.
Yes.
And then, here's how you do it. Well, they did that in Tarzana, which was great. They used Tarzana Recreation Center, the park. And they organized around there because there was a school there, and it was a nice cohesive bunch of single-family residences, okay? That's wonderful. That was a customized plan. But it didn't do three blocks away, that would have worked. Three blocks to the east, what they did there would not have worked. It just flat out wouldn't have. Because that's all apartments three blocks to the east.
West Hills is unique, 98% single family homes.
Right. But, I mean, for you it would be easier.
Right.
Well,
literally.
But for us it wasn't. Valley Village just wanted to everybody know that 9+ hour power outage in our area, and talk about needing a disaster plan.
Uh huh. Yeah, I know, as I say, my problem was I got stuck on and off the freeway at Laurel Canyon.
It was a nightmare, so really, it was really difficult. We have people in my building that were elderly, the elevators were out, there was no air, how to get them downstairs, how to get them to a cool place, those kinds of things.
Okay.
Just that.
This is all part of emergency planning, and I think Bob has said it, others have said it. It doesn't have to be the San Andreas letting down.
Right.
Okay? It doesn't have to be. It could be a lengthy power outage. It could be a freighter blowing up in the harbor, okay? What do you do when that happens? Where are the people that are in a wheelchair that can't get down a flight of stairs, and how do you do that, okay? So this is part of what, you know, we're talking about. Yeah, it's a great impetus to know that, as my friend Kate says, who recently retired from Caltech, here are the things that can happen when the San Andreas, if you ever want to get really, really nervous, Kate Hutton shows a real nice slideshow, and she shows second by second what happens when a certain portion of the San Andreas lets go. And you go, oh my, you know. But that doesn't have to be, that's the impetus for putting this together. But that doesn't have to be the only thing. Because yeah, can you get a major outage? No question you can get a major outage. Can you get a local, look what's happening up in Kern County, okay?
Oh, terrible.
Just, I mean, nobody expected that. That thing has just exploded. I know that the fire trucks rolled into my neighborhood and up to a small fire had started. Fortunately, it was in an area that would have burned away from my house, okay? But there are areas around the city, you'd be surprised where they are, that haven't burned in the last 40 years that could create disasters, okay?
Well, just quick in regards to the people in wheelchairs, that's where Map Your Neighborhood would come in very handy. I mean, that is huge in helping.
I have been pleading with my neighborhood council. It falls on deaf ears. You say, I go to my meeting, I tell them what we do, we need to do a plan. Everybody nods their head yes, and then they go on with their lives. On that day when the power went out, everybody's calling me. Seriously, and what? They were like, what do we do?
Now, what do we do? Oh, well, what I do is I hook into my large, fully charged batteries or start my generator, one of the two, okay? Yeah, that's what I do.
Okay. You are almost unique in this situation. Okay, how long has Map Your Neighborhood been in existence as an idea?
Over 20 years.
20 years. How many neighborhoods are mapped?
No idea.
Okay. My guess is it's vanishingly close to zero, that Map Your Neighborhood is what I call a then a miracle happens scenario, and that we need to have a better way.
Yeah.
And well, that's great. Down where I live, we have 27,000 people in my neighborhood council district. It's never been done. The other 70 or so thousand people in San Diego, it's never been done. And people move in and people move out.
Yeah.
I just, you know, I don't want to spend a lot of time arguing the negatives of it. I just don't see it as real popular in the same sense that people used to go door to door doing political campaigning. And they would knock on doors. And what we found 15 or 20 years ago is people stopped doing that. They didn't feel comfortable doing it. They won't do it. So.
Well, we have iPhones and Facebook for that now, but I would suggest that Nextdoor.com is doing something that can be where there's an ability to communicate.
Yeah, it's a more efficient way of doing it.
Yeah, they
if
absolutely
it is done.
Help, but you've got to push them to do it.
Right.
But they have an open manager that's willing to listen.
Understood. So the city leadership, starting at Garcetti and that whole organization, ought to be trying to move the city toward
you know
mapping.
The biggest positive about Next Door Neighbor that I heard when we had a presentation from years ago, was in Cheviot Hills, there were a bunch of burglaries going on. The entire community was alerted, everybody was excited about it. So yeah, everybody joined it, they got rid of the burglaries, and that's their star, you know, story. I tell you what, to me, the biggest issue as far as any of this goes, Lynn, and it's probably goes without saying, is gaining interest from the people. You have to have enthusiastic people to map your neighborhood, to get anything going. How many neighborhood councils are represented here? Probably about, what, 12, maybe 13, out of the 93? Okay.
96.
So you have, I'm sorry?
96.
96, thank you. So basically, the bottom line is that it's like anything else. You know, I send out to my personal neighborhood, I have 40 residences because we went through this. I had an individual party in Bel Air. They had somebody really good that did this. They had 12 different street captains throughout 2,400, I think, residences or something like that. Everybody had about 250. I had Upper Bel Air Road, and I gave a party. It was hot dogs, hamburgers, send it out to all the neighbors, this, that, and the other. It had 25 people that showed up there, 30 people or so. Since then, I have a list of 40 people that I've kept up over the years. Nobody else did. The thing faded. The problem is interest, motivation, marketing, and that type of thing. And if you can't get your neighborhood councils involved in it, and if you're last on the agenda or emergency preparedness doesn't come up with anything, you're SOL, period, okay? It's about marketing and getting people interested, and it's all marketing. Make them sick, make them well. If they're not sick, they don't care about it.
Okay, good thought.
Just a thought.
Good thought, no, good thought. Good thought. Any of you around when we first did the MOU with DWB?
It was a lot, if
that's
what you mean.
Huh? Any of you go out to neighborhood councils and talk about the MOU and why a neighborhood council should support it?
We had people who did.
Question. Ideas. Maybe out of these groups, we can look around various parts of the city and say, huh, who's willing to go to your alliance? Who's willing to go to neighborhood councils? Who's willing to go talk this up? Okay? What would I like to do? What would I like to see? What would Gracie love to see? Every neighborhood council appoint somebody to the EP Alliance, just like Board of Public Works, Budget Advocate, okay? Who knows? Maybe there'd be some kind of budget. But I'm just throwing that out. But that would be the way to sell this, okay? You know, you've got to get a core of interested people. And there's a lot of people around this community, around this city, that are interested in emergency preparedness. And if we could get them a place to come to talk about it, to organize it, to work on selling it to others, that would be a first step. So let's think about that kind of thing. I've just made a note to myself here.
Yeah. Lynn, I tell you what, you have the key, I think, and the key is Gracie. If Gracie, if all of a sudden she's going to say, listen, next month or the month after, whatever, the biggest thing on our agenda is neighborhood councils is emergency preparedness. What we'd really like to see people do is volunteer rather than be appointed. Because if somebody's appointed, they don't have the enthusiasm.
Most people who get appointed to something like that, when you say, here's what I'd like to do, who wants to, and they raise their hand at your neighborhood council, that's the people you appoint.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
You need somebody that's enthusiastic about it because they have to be enthusiastic, and that drives the rest of the people
involved. When I say appointed, it's like at my meeting, I said, okay, who wants to be a budget rep? Not a budget advocate, just a budget rep. A couple of people said, hey, I'll go do that. And because I say, you don't have to be a budget advocate, here's what you do as a budget rep. Well, if you say, who wants to be an emergency preparedness representative? So maybe you don't do the training, but at least you gather the information to bring it back to us as to what's going on. And that's the important part here. And then I'll tell you something about...
Well, you know, the thing about
being appointed is that, yeah, you have a good strong start, but you have a petered out situation, for instance. We're at the end of our term right now, and it's probably out of, I don't know, 30-some budget advocates. There's really only maybe less than a dozen that actually participate. And so, you know, you're going to have the same situation.
You may. But the idea is, let's get a starting point. You know, so those 12 people are still there. Let me point out one thing. This right here is because of a recommendation that Gracie made. Okay, to me, and I won't go into the whole detail, it's kind of a funny thing that I brought up something and she said, oh, by the way. And that was because the mayor had just had his presentation on emergency preparedness and tasked different departments to do something. And neighborhood empowerment, one of their tasks was to get this information out to neighborhood councils. And this is the way we're doing it. By the way, right now, if you can tell your other, and if you want to review them, one, we've got, what, the first three of these meetings are on Empowerment LA's YouTube. Oh, and if you go up on Empowerment LA YouTube and then do a search for emergency preparedness, we come up, okay? And I'm going to bug Tom and one other person. I got to come up with a fancy title. We will get our own webpage on Empower LA. And all of these will be up there, and other things we want to post, like the Notify LA, like the five-step program, like the links, we can put them up there. Okay, so we've got the cooperation of the departments. That's why Tom is here, doing this filming. So we do have that, and when I call, I can get cooperation.
Quick comment on this.
Yeah, Bob.
We have a tendency to talk about sort of administrative details and titles and how we're going to get somebody to have a particular title. And my thought, when I heard Lucy Jones's talk and came to the first meeting was, oh, okay, this is a chance to get the additional 10,000 to 20,000 volunteers that the city needs. Because with 4 million people in the city and another 8 or so million people in the rest of the county, if we have a big earthquake or some sort of disaster, you're on your own. And we all know that. I wrote that column several times. So where I'm going with this is that the neighborhood councils are an element in creating an emergency preparedness alliance. But the emergency preparedness alliance is something that can be in addition to and even apart from the neighborhood council system. It can be hand in glove with the neighborhood council system. I've got a personal axe to grind on this, which is I'm tired of fighting with the hate group that's taken over my neighborhood council, and yet I would still like to be involved in emergency preparedness. So I'd like to see a little bit different model than the each neighborhood council board votes to appoint two people to go to a budget advocates meeting. Yeah, that's a political issue. That's appropriate for neighborhood councils. This is something that might be a little bit more important.
Okay. Moving a little bit more forward.
Just clarify one thing.
Go ahead.
Your e-blasts, though, go, theoretically, if the rosters are up to date, are going to all board members.
Yeah, right. Now, so, I did not do that for this one, because they're just so out of sync.
Okay,
yeah.
So this one was just based on?
It was based on,
attendance.
I've got a collection of people. It goes out to about 80 people, plus city officials, certain city officials, because they say, keep us informed.
Okay.
And I got response from some of them, hi, thank you very much, keep doing this, blah, blah, blah. So they know we're here. They're always aware of it.
So my point was,
go ahead.
So with the exception of this one, is that notwithstanding of how you get to appoint a representative to this group or two or whatever, is that everyone's invited because, again, assuming the board rosters are updated, the e-blast is...
Yeah.
Yeah, right? They're getting notification of the...
Yeah, this meeting and the meeting before was strictly the group, okay? Because of what was going on with elections. The next one for July will start with a full on blast again, saying, okay, here we are, here's what we're doing, you're all welcome, please come, and we'll see what happens. Maybe I should jump to MailChimp. I gotta send things out in segments so that, as long as I keep under 2,000 names, MailChimp is free. And of course, there's also other little things you can do, so they don't really think you're a spammer. Yeah, there's a couple things. By the way, they ever cut you off as a spammer, turn off your
cookies.
Well, no. Turn off your computer and turn off your router for about 4 hours, then turn it back on again, you get a new IP address, and you start all over again. Because they do it by IP address.
Lynn, you know what could make sense is if you, obviously, I think most of the people in the room here are either seasoned, you've been to most of the meetings, you have a good feeling for what's going on with ED, okay? A lot of intelligence here. And the issue is that you need new blood. And to get the new blood, they come to a meeting like this and they start talking, hearing about the radio lens, and which I didn't even understand, but really cared to understand.
Well, somebody asked me that question.
No, I'd like to get her. Okay.
Okay.
Anyway, it would be maybe to have new blood or type of meeting where you go back to the basics and, hey, how do you do this? How do you map? How do you, just different facets or whatever. And that's what it is. It's about basics.
Well, what
talking about outreach.
Outreach is exactly. Thank you.
What I'd like to see is, like I say, I want to try and get somebody from Topanga because they've got a good disaster program in Topanga.
It's excellent.
Yeah, it's very good. I'd like to do that exercise that Bob, so that people can say, okay, is this how it really works with radios? Is this how you're going to communicate with somebody? This is a hands-on type of thing. Perhaps people from other organizations who are involved in emergency preparedness to say, how do you map it? Here's how you do it. Here's how you sit down with your computer and you do this, okay? And these could be learning situations, but...
Sorry for the delay, folks.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I was finding the videos.
I would still like to, and I think it's still important for this group to make certain things. One is a customizable plan, some kind of outline, because I think neighborhood councils, because of who they are and what they are more willing to accept things from neighborhood councils than from others, okay? Especially if it's a group effort. Then we've got to decide how do you organize, you know, neighborhood councils throughout the city. I mean, because you want neighborhood councils to talk to neighborhood councils in case of a disaster.
Yes.
You know, do you organize them geographically? Do you organize them the same as the bureaus are? You got to come up with some idea, and there's got to be some interaction. You're over in Bel Air, Brentwood area, and one of the things that I looked at was there's a bunch of people in Encino that were getting trained on...
ACS. Ham radios.
Ham radios. And I'm thinking to myself, hey guys, do you understand that you aren't going to be able to talk to Bel Air and places like that with your handheld radio? Because there's this great big huge mound of dirt between you guys and it doesn't work that way. So how are you going to do that? Well, through ACS.
Michael Shankler is part of it. He's actually a subcommittee to my committee, okay, and that's how it got started, but believe me, he has done wonders, and he is reaching out. We have people in Studio City now. We would like the idea, we have people getting, Skirball is flanking, if you will, our west. Studio City's flanking our east, okay. We have Humpy Hills below us, which is flanking our south. And we'd love people all over the place to continue to expand. So they have a group which is open to everyone. It's not just our council. And Michael Shankler's done an excellent job with that. Okay. So that's number one. Two, he's a part of Bel Air Crest. It's written up in the LA Times. And they didn't like the way it was presented. But however, they have $50,000 in emergency preparedness supplies, including a water tender, which is, I think, out of about 2,000 gallons of water, which is, I think the average fire truck's got 500.
Okay. Yeah, that's a community that's done.
It's a community thing, but they can map, because on our website, we went and took pictures of the porta potties, all the supplies they have. It's all on our website, and emergency preparedness, and basically, they map and they could tell you exactly what they did. And there are, I can tell you what Bel Air Association did because I was one of the 12th Street captains. So I can tell you what they did, how they went about it. We gave a little party, put flyers out to all the different people, just 8.5 by 11. My little kids did hot dogs, hamburgers, and all the artistic stuff on it. We had people over. I'm from New Orleans, so we had drinks and hot dogs and hamburgers and everything. And basically, meet your neighbor. We have on my list that I send out to this group that I've kept up in the neighborhood of about maybe 12, 13 doctors. They all have their names, their addresses, their telephone numbers, their cell phones. Everything goes out to everybody. It's a little neighborhood deal, and it's just worked for us.
No, that's
just as an idea.
That's the way it's supposed to work. That's the way the five step is supposed to work.
And
that's
the grassroots. It's got to be grassroots and interest. Somebody's got to organize.
Right, and that's a private organization.
What is?
We're out there in Bel Air. Okay.
Bel Air's nothing private about it. I live on Bel Air Road. Anybody can drive up.
No. When I say okay, you raised $50,000 or whatever. Okay.
No, Bel Air Crest.
Bel Air Crest.
One of the neighborhood councils. Okay. Bel Air Association.
Right.
Is a different one altogether.
Right. I know.
We've got 12 of them.
And as a private group of citizens, you can do all kinds of things.
There's an HOA. Most of you guys have a neighborhood council. You don't have homeowner associations. Now, your condos have them, okay?
Right.
But basically, it's the same theory.
I understand. But these are private citizen organizations. They're a little different than neighborhood councils.
They have a little more control over getting interest from their
people. They also have a way they can conduct meetings. They have a way that they can raise money.
Exactly.
All kinds of
things. That's true.
All kinds of
things. Okay. No, that's true.
Okay. But if we put together the right kind of organization, if we get enough neighborhood councils interested, okay?
That's it.
Then we can talk to the city and say, okay, here's what we need, here's what we want to do, here's where we want to go, here's how much it's going to cost. We could look at neighborhood councils and say, okay, on a certain idea, are you willing to put out X number of dollars per year for this? And how do we set this up so that next year's board doesn't say no? How do we go on for 5 years or 8 years? How do we do this? And if we can do this, if neighborhood councils will come up with something, as Miguel Santana says, you come in with an idea and you tell me where you're going to find part of that money, and maybe we can find money to manage, okay? But don't come to me and say, we give you 100%. You tell me how you're going to help finance this. Okay? So if neighborhood councils can do that, either through themselves or through HOAs in their area and such as that, now we've got some leverage and now we've got some. These are all great ideas. And yeah, HOAs, as I say, are different. People, some of them are just HOAs with volunteers, some are HOAs where everybody pays dues because the things that they've got there and everything else. We've got a couple of areas in Tarzana that are gated, and they run their own, and one of these wonderful gated, some celebrity just got hit for $500,000 on a burglary. I wonder how that happens when you've got a gated community with walls all around.
It's like,
whoops, didn't turn my alarm on. They pay money, they pay dues, and they have a management company, some of them, that run the place. So they can raise money, and they can put things together, and it's easier for them. But that doesn't mean that we can't work with them. That doesn't mean that neighborhood councils can't put together dollars from their own budgets and get the city to say, okay, you guys are that interested, we'll find some money to help fund this kind of thing.
How about a meet your neighbor for emergency preparedness thing and get it funded and have, they're not going to have liquor obviously, but you know, hot dogs or anything.
By the way, neighborhood councils, you can have something like that. You can have a town hall, public preparedness town hall, emergency preparedness, have a couple of speakers, you can buy food for it. You can do that, okay? That's legitimate. You know, we throw a what's it called? An Earth Day. By the way, you could partner with, the HOA should partner with the, what's it called, the chamber in your area, okay? Let them do some of the work. If you've got a park there and you're good with the administrators from, I'll get to you in a minute, with the administrators for the park, you can let Rec and Parks partner with you, and then all of a sudden, you're out of the woods for any permits, okay? If you've got a, you know, if you've got a barbecue and you're cooking food, legally, you're supposed to A, have a health permit, and B, clearance from the fire department, especially if it's a lighted grill, okay? You gotta have those clearances.
I thought you were a Republican.
No, I've got somebody back here already.
I know, I want to say something.
No, I got somebody back here. I got somebody back here already. But these are the kind of things, yes, we can do.
Yeah, when we, one day in Pennsylvania Life, I work with Toluca Lake, we do a Black Captain's appreciation, an annual thing, where we, where the stakeholders come there, we do a, it's like a big potluck, and we have the LAPD, the fire department there, emergency preparedness people there, and also some of the vendors, like the patrol people, private patrol people, and the locksmith, people.
SOS.
It's like, yeah, it's everything. So anything you could possibly want, emergency preparedness and public safety, and we do that at that, you know, once a year, it's an annual thing.
Yeah.
It's a big turnout.
That's it.
But, I mean, you know.
That's right there.
We.
Pretty standard.
I'll keep calling it, and then we're going to finish up in a minute. Last year at the Granada Hills Group, that's coming up again this year, neighborhood councils in the valley donating, we had 23 neighborhood councils represented, and those were from South LA through the valley, okay? And you can do that. And that would be a great place, perhaps, you know, set up a booth from the Alliance and have things, hit on those neighborhood councils that are up there. That kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I know that five neighborhood councils in CD3 joined together to have an emergency preparedness fair. That's the kind of place where we need to be and do it. Your next one.
Quick question. We funnel much of our funds back into the community for community improvement projects. Could we fund such a project if the EP Alliance came in with a request?
No. The EP Alliance can't because, well, you can't do it as an NPG because we're not a 501c3.